After one of my talks in Amsterdam on the advanced agriculture and farming industry, somebody approached me and he said, I got inspired by your story, we need to talk. So we had a conversation. It is a person that I really admire. He's a philanthropic entrepreneur with a purpose, a transformational purpose. He's really dedicated to making this world and his food production CO2 positive. He said, fuck CO2 neutral, Igor. I can bring it to the next levels and I will show you how. So he invited us to visit his business, which is a benchmark for farming worldwide. It is really an amazing tour. I would like to introduce you to the company named Coppert Crest. His name is Rob Baan, and he will take us on a tour in his advanced company. Follow me. Entitled you like the most advanced grower in, well, Europe or the world.
And surroundings.
And surroundings, planet Mars. Yeah. A pleasure to meet you. Thank you very much for your invitation.
You're welcome.
I would like to start with who is Rob Baan and when did you start this business?
Well, I'm a grower, born and raised in Haarlem in a city. So, and my father's a policeman, so that makes the whole story very complete. Okay. It's very logical.
Yeah.
My father taught me a lot of things about to eat in the dunes near Haarlem. And I thought it was normal that you know what you can eat in the forest and in the dunes. And then when I talked to my friends, they didn't know that. So that was strange. And I kept that story. And now I'm traveling around the world, catching, finding plants, finding taste, and bringing it to the gastronomy. And I'm selling it to the biggest chef in the world.
What did you do before you started this business?
Well, that was the nice thing. I studied, I thought I was going to study biology, because plants, nature, everything. And then I decided to go to agriculture. And based on agriculture, I started to work at the seed industry. And that time it was completely Dutch. Later on it became multinational and internationally owned. And I worked for 22 years worldwide in the seed industry. I traveled in about 80 countries, horticulturally wise. And I liked it. But I didn't like the shareholders' value approach. Yeah. It was a very short term, where seeds is a 20 years breeding process. It's a long term thing. So you're thinking long time ahead, and in half a year or a quarter is not enough to make your business work. So I didn't like it. Okay. And I didn't like that the shareholders were more important than the customers who were buying the seeds, the growers. The growers were my buddies. So I always have been thinking like a grower, with the growers. And when I got a chance to become director over here, which was a very small company, 12 people, I used to work with a team of 1,700, so that was...
When are we talking about? When you started here? 2000?
Yeah, yeah.
And then you took
turn
over?
Turn of the century, yeah.
Yeah? And you took over in?
In 2002.
Okay.
And then I really could bring the message like I wanted. So create a market pool over the consumer, over the chefs, over the trade. And I worked on the chefs, gave them all these flavors, these surprises. And they start ordering backward in the chain, and that was making the company proud and big and
nice
and profitable. Yeah,
we had the same. I think that was the match. I fled the corporate world for the same reason: focus on next quarters and not on next generations.
But I learned a lot because the industry is very smart. You get very good trainings and so on.
Yeah.
But the way they manage the company is just the thing that's missing. So, I found out that I was more an intrapreneur. Then a laborer in the company. And this entrepreneurship gave me a lot of headache because I was always fighting everybody. And I didn't know why, but it was more, I had my own ideas, my own business approach, and the company was very useful for me, not the other way around. And when I started here, they came back on this big multinational and said, what happened? Why are you doing so successfully now? So, because you guys are not here. Now I can do how I want it. And so I can take decisions quick, I can decide, I can change, I can do. And yeah, now we have about 300 people again, and we are looking for international expansion. We have a company, a partnership in Japan, Australia, United States, Belarus, Colombia. We're looking for much more partnerships around the
Very
world
nice.
To do this whole thing again.
You want to break with the status quo. You don't take interest in products, you create new products.
Yes.
You are the guy, and that's why I wanted to be here, who said CO2 neutral, carbon neutral. I want to be carbon positive. Well, can you tell me a bit about your drivers and why is that?
Some people call it visionary. I just found out recently that most probably it's DNA issue, that my DNA is not satisfying me with just being good. I want to be beyond that. I want to have next challenges. Company goes very well at the moment, so I'm very I'm unresty. I don't feel comfortable. There has to be happiness.
But you have to be outside the status quo. That's what we also talked about, is mostly passion and frustration are the drivers of the Steve Jobs. It was never like this before. It should have been like this already for 5 years. I will do it.
Yes.
And but you're doing it.
Yeah, and it works, and it works profitable, and it's funny, and it's rewarding. And you see a lot of innovations over here, so those white chimneys you see are the heat collectors making the hot air from the greenhouse into hot, warm water and cold air. So we cool the greenhouse with the high temperature, taking the heat out, harvesting it, putting it in the ground. So I'm heating now my greenhouse with the summer of last year.
Yeah, amazing.
That's fun. That's not just the money, it's the fun that you can do it like that.
But is it also the kick that you get out of, because you might be even the guy you are awarded, but you might even set new levels for circular and for CO2
positivity. That's what horticulture is. There are many, many smart guys in horticulture inventing and inventing and inventing.
Yeah.
And in horticulture it's open source, we exchange that with each other.
Yeah.
So these Dutch guys are always improving. And the greenhouse builders can profit from this and export this to international.
Yeah.
And by that we can make it a better world.
You are bringing the oldest industry on the planet to whole new levels.
Yeah,
is that the DNA, culture, mindset? Are you freaks? Why are you so, I'm so curious.
When you're working close with nature, nature always rewards you with all kinds of information, new insights, new things. Yeah. And I love working with nature because they're much smarter than we ever will be.
Yeah.
And so I learn every day from nature. That's why I have to be very careful with nature, because it's my future and the future of the company.
Yeah.
Nature is our friend, it's not
our
enemy.
You have children? So that's
four children, grandpa, I mean, things are coming now.
Is that the responsibility that people also need? I think for me, when I talk to my children, I think that we have borrowed the planet from them.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
we have to take much better care of what we made a mess out of the world.
You can't live from the credit card of your children. I like that one.
Yeah, true.
But I think even without children, I would be doing it. But it really helps. And I can tell you, when you become a grandfather, I had no idea that it was so much giving you this responsibility, more than with children.
Yeah.
And but still, it's our responsibility, because also my employees have children and grandchildren and so on. So we have to be very careful about it.
Yeah. What can we do and what can we change in our food habits to go back to?
Well, that's easy. In Holland, again, innovation. We call it Dutch cuisine. And we said, look, if you go back to the history of Dutch cuisine, everybody says Holland has no kitchen. Bullshit. It has a very long history on food. Back to the Roman time. All kind of things in the present dishes are coming from the Roman times. In the old times, we were never eating such a huge amount of meat.
No.
And the meat is so cheap and it's so available that everybody eats meat because it's very nice, it's tasty and so on.
Yeah.
But you're killing the planet.
Yeah. You mean the carbon footprint?
Well, not only that, but also just the footprint of the square meters. In a greenhouse, you can be very efficient. Very, very efficient. Year round, like I said, CO2 neutral, you can produce year round. That's one thing. But the vegetables have a much higher production per square meter than meat. To give an idea, you can feed Rotterdam with 1 million people, it's less, but let's say 1 million people, with 3,000 hectares of vegetables, of which about 200 hectares is glasshouse.
Yeah.
And the rest is outdoor.
If we compare it to
meat? 75,000 at least.
Wow.
And Rotterdam is eating 750 hectares of vegetables, but 75,000 hectares of meat. And that's wrong, because then you have to clean forests to make more production areas.
Yeah.
If we eat 20% meat compared to what we're doing today, you can feed 45 billion people on the same planet without chopping one rainforest.
Yeah.
So we're doing it very stupid. Just change the food behavior a little bit. Health-wise is very good.
Yeah.
Energy-wise is good. Yeah. Service-wise is good. And people are more fit, so it works.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to set today also, a benchmark for the world, that the oldest industry on the planet, which farming and agriculture is setting the benchmark itself.
Yes, but then, the growers should think by themselves, not by multinationals telling them what to do. And the big slaughterhouses.
But you can also run this. This is not a subsidized thing. This is a business.
It's doing pretty well.
Yeah, no, but that means that it's possible.
Yes.
And that there is no more excuses. Yeah, but then I will lose my business. No way. No.
We are very strong in selling things too cheap.
Yeah.
And food is your issue. Look how much you want to pay for medicines. That's ridiculous. When it comes to medicines, you pay everything.
You
sell your car just to buy the medicines.
Yeah.
When it comes to food, it has to be cheap. Ridiculous. It's your basis.
It's the most important medicine for life, I think, maybe.
Yeah.
If I would like to ask you two things. Your dream for this company in, let's say, 2030, what would it be?
I want to have the permission to say that my products are healthy.
Yeah.
So to give an idea, medicines like metformin, which you consume against diabetes, are based on plants.
Yeah.
If I want to say my plants are healthy, they say, ho, that's pharmaceutical industry, stay off, it's not your turf. But these plants are the basis of metformin.
Yeah.
So I want to be able to grow a plant to say this is containing metformin. Then all the proofs of metformin are done by the pharmaceutical industry, and I can sell the plant as a healthy product.
Yeah.
Now, if I say broccoli is protecting you against all kinds of diseases, I get a penalty. It's hanging in the corridor.
Yeah.
No. Ministry of Agriculture, bam. Ministry of Food and
But
and,
why are we stopping down nature and innovation? Because it doesn't fit our traditional.
Look at the industries who make the money.
Yeah.
It's the food industry, the pharmaceutical industry. They want to protect that turf. That's their area.
Do you imagine that you would have your own label in 10 years' time? Your benchmark
that's,
for what
that's
is
too long. Come on.
Five?
No, next
Three?
Year. Next year.
Yeah, okay. Well, I like you.
Yeah.
I like the pace.
Everything what you want, normally you can do it today.
Yeah, that's right.
If you start talking about 5 years, you say, well, I don't have time.
Yeah.
There's no priority. And you say 10 years, you don't want to do it.
Okay.
Look at ministers. When they talk about in 10 years' time you solve the problem, they think, oh, there's two governments more, we are out. So when I store the energy in the ground, which I will do the coming year, with when we have a thermal, we're going to drill 3 kilometers deep, so we get thermal heat, then I can heat The Hague.
The whole city of The Hague.
So in the summertime, when nobody needs the heat, I harvest it, put it in the ground. Yeah. In the wintertime, when everybody wants the heat, I can give it for free to the city.
Is that why you say it can be done in a few years? Circular positive is a no-brainer, actually.
It's a no-brainer, but the thing is, it takes a long time to get the permissions. Too much time. Yeah. Bullshit. We know that you can drill it. Drill it now.
But the sense of urgency is clear that we need it faster than...
Yeah, but in Dutch you say the toekomst heeft haast.
Yeah.
The future's in a hurry.
Yeah.
I said geothermal is nogal wiebes.
Yeah.
Nogal wiebes.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you really want to change, not because we have to change, but you really want to change, go to geothermal.
Yeah.
Yeah, we in horticulture, we can collect all the heat, 10,000 hectares. In the time we don't need it, we supply the cities.
Yeah. And for you as a person, your dream beyond this company, but for planet Earth?
Planet Earth, I want to have many of these companies around the world. I want to teach the story that you don't need salt.
Yeah.
To make a dish tasty, but you can use the real flavors.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can make you a real flavor. I mean, so. It's a cumin taste. If you add it to a soup, you don't need salt to the soup.
Yeah, I don't recognize the flavor. That's so weird. And you told me about you teach a lot of little children how to get in contact with nature again.
Yeah.
They can taste what for them might be plants, trees, and flowers.
Many of them are scared to eat plants, because daddy told them, oh, well, plants, well, you never know, and so on.
Yeah.
But plants are your friends.
Yeah.
We're made to live in harmony with plants.
Yeah. For me, it's really amazing, because if you look at the world in a bigger picture, there's 1 billion people living in poverty, and there is 2 billion people overweight or obese.
Yes.
So this is not a nice to have. This methodology is a lifesaver for 2 billion people right now already.
I think we can produce the products against diabetes, against cancers. This is going to be the pharmacy of the future.
Yeah. Back to nature, basically.
Yeah, nature is our guide. So most medicines are made from plants from nature.
Amazing, eh? That with all the technology and the skills and that we have, that we fucked up the planet in a way that...
And now you have to eat a pill to be healthy. And I always keep saying, your digestion system, your very complicated digestion system for plants, is very old-fashioned. It's more than a million years old.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what we're doing now is we're eating pills. If we were made for pills, there's a small hole inside of our head to put a pill in, not a complex digestion system.
Yeah.
That's where we go wrong.
Yeah.
We looked at the artificial solution for something that you can do natural.
Do you want to show me three things that you're most proud of in this company? Can we tour around?
I do it in my kitchen, because that's a place where we have all kind of flavors and where you can see how chefs use it.
I look forward to that.
Okay.
Thank you for so far.
So welcome to my kitchen.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a serious one. There are three in the world. And
what is it? Tell us.
It's a Molteni Podium 4, and it's made for show cooking.
Sounds French.
Yes.
French cuisine?
Mr. Molteni had an original system was that you had a hot part on the stove and a cold part, and you would shove with your cooking utensils. So you don't put heat on and off, you just move it.
Wow.
That was the idea. Then they made it modern. Now it's from Electrolux, so it's more Italian design and so on. And I wanted to show that I'm not just producing herbs for decoration, but you can really cook with it.
Yeah.
So many of the big chefs have been here to cook and to really find out what's coming. Now, if I invite a chef to come to my greenhouse, well, I've been to greenhouses, it's fine.
Yeah.
If you tell a chef, shall we film you with a Podium 4 of Molteni?
This boy?
Whoa.
Yeah?
It's like when you are asked to go to... Monza and to drive in Testarossa.
Yeah.
You take your car and you go there, or you take the plane, because no questions asked, you go.
The experience is...
So this is for a chef, this kitchen is like that. And here we have the chance to really communicate with people what we have, why we cook things, and what the combination. And we can check things, we can test it. Now, this is something you might be surprised about it. You have to roll it together.
Thank you very much.
And there's no poison, no torture, is it?
It is. But I'm eating...
When you go to a restaurant and people are offered oysters and they don't like it, then the chef comes, may give you a vegetarian oyster.
People won't believe me. If I tell you this tastes like eating an oyster, you will say you're an idiot.
No, it's 180. Oh, it's perfect.
But most of the things we don't even know. We don't even recognize the flavors. You showed us something with...
Now there's something else. We didn't taste this one yet. It was very busy for us to sell this plant because we had...
Looks like a flower,
With Valentine.
Yeah.
It has a heart shape, so that's why it was very popular.
It's watery, soury, it's...
Granny Smith.
Yeah, it's like an apple.
Yeah. It's not the apple, but...
No, but the taste is that we can only compare with what we know.
Yeah. This is a nice flavor as well. I found this 4,000 meters high in Peru. Peru, maybe you know, is a very popular kitchen now for haute cuisine.
Yeah.
A lot of trends are coming in. Ferran Adria made him famous. And now, and the Japanese made him famous.
Look, it's like a very small, romantic...
Beschuit met muisjes.
Now, but this is, yeah. Yeah. But people serve in Holland when you have a baby and it's flavored, it's in that little flour.
Yeah, it's not, but it's the same flavor.
If you don't want to answer me, what is the next level of flavors that you want to invent or find or?
I'm going to Armenia in May.
For?
Plant hunting.
Yeah.
With some people are Armenian.
Who do you take with you with plant hunting? That's a special team with
some volunteers because you never taste first. No, a joke. No, I know what to taste. So very often the local foragers, because many people do still foraging, elderly ladies very often, they go with us, we eat this season, that season, and so on. Preferably a chef, preferably a local chef, because they know how to play with it. And some guides who can bring me to the right people to really introduce me, otherwise it looks like stealing.
Do you have an idea how many species that are still undiscovered out there?
10,000.
10,000 species?
We were in Spain, north of Spain, Basque area.
Yeah.
Basque Culinary
Beautiful.
Center.
Yeah.
I'm teaching sometimes over there. We went for the plant hunters to find out what, because many restaurants are selling plants hunted from the forest.
Yeah.
And I don't like it, because you, with plant hunting, you can feed 7 million people.
Yeah.
You can't feed people with 7 billion plants from nature. You can't.
No.
Impossible.
So we went looking and I said, okay, I'm not going to promote this, but show me the plants. I see if I can grow them in the greenhouse. That's really the ancient horticulture. You find something in nature, you domesticated it in a greenhouse. Can you grow it? Can you get the flavor? Yes. Okay.
So we can still keep respecting nature.
And then you leave
it
like
it
is. And you produce what you want in the greenhouse. And then you employ people, it's funny, it's and a new flavor again. We found 42 different flavors.
It's amazing.
That is Charlie in the Chocolate Factory.
I can imagine.
I'm so happy.
No, but that's my reinventing, exploring. It's a sort of exploration, 10,000 species.
Yeah, and it goes deeper. I got a nice story from an ethnobotanist. I didn't know the job was existing, but apparently you are an ethnobotanist who knows the relation between people and plants. And in Spain, the shepherds go into the mountains to collect their shepherd salad, because a shepherd goes into the mountains for 3 months. He doesn't bring his own fridge with everything with him, so he's just collecting everything. So in this field, the Spanish were harvesting this product, this salad. That's the Spanish shepherd salad. In one particular field. 100 years later, the Basque shepherds were in the same field, making a completely different salad from the same field. So I'm thinking about making a book of the international shepherd salad around the world, because every shepherd has the same problem.
Yeah.
Collect your food around you.
I can imagine that San Sebastian is also very famous for its food.
It's a nice area.
Yeah?
I have a lot of customers over there.
Oh yeah?
Yes.
Is there anything else that we didn't touch today? Architecture, aromatique. We have the biggest 1 out of 3 presses in the world, the stove.
This one is funny as well. We have Corporate Crash Earth. That's our company to do the international business.
Yeah.
But I want to have, in the future, Corporate Crash Galactic.
Yeah.
So this is Rocket Crash. So try this. This is very spicy. And this has been grown in the ISS.
No.
Yeah, they have been growing this kind of stuff.
What you mean, like we call it NASA technologies?
Yeah, yeah.
That out of space?
Yeah, that out of space, yeah.
You should talk to Elon Musk, or did you already do?
No. He goes now to urban farming, forget it.
That's his
brother, he didn't get a message.
No.
He was talking about pink lights in the greenhouse. Well, we have it here since 2010, so this is something you can grow in space. And because your body needs these nutritional young plants, this could be a good food to survive in space.
But the thing is,
so
that
you bring the seeds and then you bring it to space.
But the thing that is important is, because we talked to this before and I still want to touch upon it, 7 billion to 10 million people, we cannot live out of NASA tubes forever.
No.
This is probably the only way to feed 10 billion people. The ground, the earth, the square meters,
If you eat a nice cabbage, grown outdoors, a fantastic food.
Yeah,
one hectare of cabbage is 200 tons of food.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's 30,000 seeds. It's very limited.
Yeah.
It's easy to grow. Yeah. It's a healthy product. But we have to train ourselves against to eat the food we really need.
Yeah.
Yeah, I cannot feed 10 billion people because I have need the space to produce the seeds.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
But with meat, we're not going to make it anyway. So we have to have a solution, not only for nature, but also for our health. Yeah. So may I thank you for your introduction and your tour and your walk around. And I really admire what you do. So let's see if we can push the boundaries a bit further.